Yes, please. If you have any queries related to the previous classes, please let me know. Yeah, any queries or any point of discussion related to the previous classes? Previous interactions or the previous materials. Regarding the assignment, I will discuss with you at the end of this today's session. Apart from that, any queries? Is my screen visible to you, please?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, please. If you are not having any queries at this moment, I will start with this topic, everything as a service and the role of cloud in the IoT. So last week we are discussing about something once called as device management and the data management, which is basically related to the IoT. So if you can recollect the last week's discussion, what are the different types of devices that we use it in the IoT environment? Can anybody please respond? Hello. Yeah,
microcontroller sensors.
Different types of devices, the classification, of course, microcontroller sensors are also your devices only. But what is the name that we are discussing in the based on the last week's class? If you see here, can you see my screen now? So we is,
yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah, so here, machine to machine and the IoT technology fundamentals. So this is the topic which we have discussed in the last week. So here we have something called as device, different types of devices. What are these different types of devices that we discussed here? If you go to the next slide, you'll get the answer.
Basic and advanced.
Yes. Simple, very simple answer, basic and advanced. So what are to be called as advanced devices? For what purpose we'll use for the advanced devices in the IoT platforms?
They have an OS in them.
Yes, exactly. They have an operating system. Basically, they have been treated as an gateways. So those gateways, basically, they are the gateways. They have an operating system as well as your networking communication protocols. So here, what are the different types of data that you foresee on the IoT management? So there are different types of data. You can call it as a heterogeneous data. You can have a big data, real-time data, temporal data, spatial data, polymorphic data, proprietary data. So these are the different types of data that you play with the in the IoT environment for various purposes. Then we went for the business processes. So your business, various aspects of applications, you can say your health applications or your transportation applications or your retail or your any different types of real world relevant processes, we are going to realize it with the help of your IoT setups and where your different business applications are running in a different architectural scenarios. So if you see here, this is what the diagram, the distributed business processes. Because you are using the cloud computing environment, and most likely the cloud computing environment is now having the distributed process management. But the distributed process management also has got certain disadvantages, and we move from the cloud management to the data origin itself. So the main purpose is to move your computations from the cloud computing to your very near to the data origin used to. So what is the main reasons for this? You see, the traditional business processes, all the data is being computed at the cloud or at the enterprise level. But whereas in the distributed business processes, most of the computations are happening very near to the data origin, not at the entirely at the cloud. So may I know what is the reason behind this? So the point which you are discussing here on this diagram.
So real-time computations.
Yes, of course. One of the reason is to do real-time computations. So the real-time computations can be happening only when you are doing those computations very near to the data origin rather than at some other layer or other some other place. Apart from real-time computations, the other thing is on the latency, the delay in getting the responses for the distributed business process is less because the data computations are happening very near to the data origin. The delay or the latencies are also less here. So those are the some of those advantages which we are discussing in the last classes. So today let us go on with the next topic. Something is on everything as a service using cloud computing and the role of cloud in the IoT frameworks. So this is what for the today's discussion and the assignment I'll be discussing at the end. So let us see here what is a cloud does for us in the IoT scenario. So if you might have seen on the left side of the figure, what we do with the cloud is that all the data processing, the data storage, and the data computations, everything is happening on the cloud. So this is what you might have seen in the last decade. So most of your data has been collected from various applications. So your end users are also there. You are going to get some inferences from the data, computed data. And all the data that is getting originated is being sent to the cloud. Can anybody tell me why we were in the initial stage, all of the data computations are happening at on the cloud itself? Why people have went for the cloud computing? Let me put the question in another way. What is the need of the cloud computations? Or why we need a cloud computing environment?
So we may not have that much. We may not have that much processing power on premise.
So the processing power on premise is very less. Yes, absolutely right. So we have less processing capabilities at the ground level, or in other terms, at the on premise level, or at the data origin level. Less processing capabilities. Is that the only reason why people went for cloud computing? Because the processing power is less. You can harness the processing capabilities on the cloud. That is the reason for people going for the cloud computing. Is that the only reason?
Sir, storage is also the major reason. Storage.
Yeah, so here the answer is there on the diagram itself. If you look closely, the data processing on the computations and the storage. See, the cloud computing, people were very much moved on to doing the data processing, the storage, and other sense of processing the data in a distributed manner with the help of cloud computing environment. Not only the data processing and the storage, if you look to the other aspects such as scalability, if you are going to keep on add your devices, more devices are going to be added. In future, if you build up an application, today you may use something around maybe 100, 150 devices or so on and so forth. Maybe in your company, you may have your computer systems or your printers or your network infrastructure or your ICT infrastructure may be limited with certain number of quantity. But later in future, if you are going to use or add more devices, or if you are going to expand your business, and if you want to share your data across your business processes and your business locations. So people have preferred for that cloud computing environment and cloud computing because with the help of cloud, you can have more infrastructure, more resources can be made use of for you to do the computations, for you to share the data, for you to have more scalable in terms of increasing your number of users, increasing number of devices, and so on and so forth. So people have had a feeling that in the initial stages of cloud computing environment, there are a lot of advantages of cloud computing. The advantages of cloud computing has come from the characteristics of cloud computing. So if you look here, what are the different characteristics of a cloud computing? So you have one important point is called as on-demand self-service. On-demand means whenever you require certain computational power, or whenever on-demand, whenever you require it, so automatically your processing and as well as your storage capabilities are being provided to you. You means here the application is being given within a very shortage, within a small amount of time, you get your required resources. So on-demand is can be done. Resource pooling, that is another characteristics of cloud computing, where your resources can be easily add upon, or it can be built upon, or it can be connected upon, and you can share those resources for your effective computations. And also you have rapid elasticity. So rapid elasticity means it can be expandable. It can be increased. More devices can be added on. It is very flexible, and also it is scalable. And of course, as long as you use those resources can be measured, and it can be quantified, and it can be charged accordingly. So here, those were the basic characteristics of your cloud computing, where most of these characteristics of cloud computing made people to realize and understand that there are a lot of advantages of cloud computing, even for IoT systems or IoT applications. And another important characteristics of cloud computing is, I have just here jot down some point, broad network access. This is basically, this broad network access is for specifically for your IoT applications or your IoT systems. So here, this broad network access means, which are having the capabilities for the network that can be accessed through various mechanisms and promote your heterogeneous thin or thick clients. Your thin or thick clients means, thin clients means basically your mobile phones or your tablets or your embedded systems. All those comes under your thin clients, and the thick clients basically which are having more processing capability, more storage, and more communication capabilities are basically called as thick clients. So this cloud computing has got a feature called broad network access that will enable your to connect various heterogeneous means different sets of devices, different sets of things, different sets of items that can be easily connected, and it can be easily accessible across the network. So that is the advantage of having or the characteristics of the cloud computing, which gives us some advantages. And if you look here carefully, the cloud computing has come into a different service models, something called as a software as a service. And of course, these terms may not be new to you. Just to give you an idea here, cloud computing has come in different forms. One form is on the software as a service. The others are like platform as a service and infrastructure as a service. And of course, now we are seeing when Internet of Things is connected, it is called as everything as a service. So let us just dwell upon what are these points here. Can anybody tell me what is meant by a software as a service? In your own word space. And in our, let us not go for the technical definitions, but let us see what is meant by software as a service.
Sir, we don't need to buy the license of a software, and we can like rent it or use it from the cloud provider. So if there is any software needed, so this is software as a service.
It is not like you can be offered from the cloud, but you need to most of the cloud service providers do charge if you are using their softwares here. So it is not that if you are going to have a free offering from the cloud itself. No, please don't get into that idea. Any other answers, please? Software as a service. Basically, you are using it in your day-to-day, in your day-to-day activities, you are using this software as a service, most of you. Can anybody give me an example, the very basic example which we use in our day-to-day?
Sir, like all the video streaming platforms.
Yes, your video streaming, your YouTube, basically YouTube, your Gmail, your email accounts. So basically you may be using certain softwares, basically those softwares as a service is being provided to you. So you're using that cloud only basically. So you all your
online compilers also, sir. Online compilers, definitely.
Yes, yes, yes. You can use those are the, of course, though some are free, some are, means it is made freely available. Some are open source. Yes, you can make use of this. But just to be, have a understanding, I was putting this point here. Now, can you give me an example for a platform as a service? One good example for a platform as a service. Where the cloud, we are using the cloud for that. Yes, please. EC2. Amazon.
EC2, sir.
EC2, yes. EC2 is going to be one of the good examples. You are getting the platform, actually, the complete set of capabilities and other resources as a service you are being given. So basically, Amazon or your Microsoft Azure, all these do service providers give us this thing available for your various applications to be run. Now, next one is another thing is where in this platform as a service, you can build up your own, you can connect your own devices and also you can build up your own platform also. Okay, now, infrastructure as a service, please. Any idea about a good example for infrastructure as a service?
Google Drive, sir.
Infrastructure. Infrastructure is basically you get the resources. So those resources or computational devices are made available to you from the cloud service provider.
Google Colab can be one of
Google
them.
Colab.
Colab.
Or Google Drive.
Google Drive is
Google
a,
Drive.
Yeah, Google Drive storage, it can be there. And most of your Microsoft products also, Microsoft photos and videos, or your Office 360, or all other things, these are Office 360, those are the softwares you might have seen. In the last decade, you are using your Microsoft products as a software which is being installed on your local systems. But now you are using Office 360, which is going to be used from the cloud only. So like this, in terms of software as a service, platform as a service, as well as infrastructure as a service, all these are now made available to us so that you can access them anywhere or everywhere too. Of course, these cloud service providers do provide these clouds in terms of various models too. So something like a private cloud. If a company wants a certain infrastructure or the company wants its own platform to be used by their employees, so they prefer to have something called in the private cloud. So that cloud infrastructure or your platform or as a software is made available only to a certain people who are designated to use it. So if at all a company who has got multinational company at different locations, they can make use of this private clouds. So there is another cloud here, community clouds, where a group of researchers or group of employees or a group of people can come together and they can run this particular cloud services. They can give you as in terms of community. So basically the educational institutions and the researchers and the freelance programmers, they do host this kind of community cloud. And of course, the public cloud, basically the government companies and the private companies, if they want to offer their services, they do look for the public clouds. And if at all a combination of above three, the private, community and public clouds, any of the combinations do exist, then we can call it as basically an hybrid cloud. So like this, the cloud is existing for us for the last decade. So if you see here, as far as the IoT is concerned, the Internet of Things is concerned, of course, cloud can do a lot of things for us, but we are now looking on to only one small topic called how this cloud is going to be benefited for our IoT, for IoT themes of applications or IoT domain. So basically, one of the benefits of having or using this cloud in the IoT is on the scalability. Scalable means because the IoT devices, if you are going to expand it, you are going to increase your the more sensing environment, you are going to look for more monitoring area, then obviously you are increasing more number of sensors and your monitoring environment is increased, and this particular thing can be easily taken care by your cloud, so that it has got a good infrastructure to capable enough to store the data, to process the data and to compute the data. So usually the IoT most important characteristic for IoT is to have a scalability, in the sense that it can be increase your more number of devices. And another important thing is for the IoT is on the data mobility. So most of the time the data is not going to be static, in the sense that it is not, you are not going to monitor certain gateways, or you are not going to monitor only a particular designated areas. So here most of the time you are going to monitor different areas where data is going to be originated from different set of sources. So basically the mobility do exist in the IoT environment. So that mobility, even if there is a mobility of the devices, or the devices is getting changed from one building to another building, or from one room to another room, or different sensors are getting changed, or it is being moved upon to other monitoring areas, then still your cloud is able to collect the data, process the data, and have the particular inferences properly. So another important thing is on the cost effectiveness. So mostly if your devices, on-premise device hosting is taking place, on-premise computational devices are there, then if you are increasing the more number of devices, and if there is a movement of those devices, then you need to deploy more infrastructure for you to do the computations, because of the scalability and the mobility of the devices. So thereby you are increasing the cost also. But when you are going to prefer for a cloud environment, the cost effectiveness is going to come into picture. So your increase in the cost can be avoided, or it can be minimized if you are preferring for a cloud environment. And another important thing is clouds acts as a remote processing power too for your IoT devices. So you can make use of your cloud to remotely monitor as well as control your IoT devices. And of course, the already one of the student has mentioned, no need for on-premises hosting. So that is what we are preferring for a cloud. So you can better opt this one. And of course, through cloud, you can have a better inter-device communications. So the device communications between device to device and device to machine, or your gateways communication, can be easily established and can be easily maintained. Now, the most important thing is on the security and the privacy of IoT data. Of course, this particular point is having a long debate, and there are a lot of pros and cons. In other terms, you need to balance these things. There is a trade-off between the usage of cloud and, of course, not using the cloud for your IoT data with respect to security and privacy. So, but to some extent, we can say the advancements of the technology, the cloud is going to be more advantageous in giving the security and privacy for your IoT data. If you look to a simple diagram here, security aspects, before we go to that, if you look to this basic diagram, if you see at the bottom level, you have your sensors, and you have your gateways, and of course at the top you have your cloud. So it can be anything, it can be cloud or a public or your private clouds or whatever it may be for data storage, processing and computations. So if you want to incorporate your security and privacy, if you want to maintain these two aspects for the IoT, that is going to be the most crucial part. So the most crucial part is that how do you incorporate your security mechanisms. Usually in the security processes involves your encryption and decryption, and as well as because of the encryption and decryption, that itself involves computation, and most of your IoT devices are resource constrained computing devices. So how best you can have your encryption and decryption is the most important point. So those is having a limitations here. So if you are going to prefer for a cloud computing setup, then of course those encryption and decryption, computational wise, you can lessen the work, but at the same time, the inferences, the delays, and the communication overheads are going to be more in number. So these are the things, it depends on all applications, what you prefer for having those security. If you're looking for some privacy incorporation, so you, most of the data that is going to be there at the IoT devices can be easily can be easily secured, as well as it can be maintained privacy if you are putting them in your private clouds, not making them to be public, and of course, and thereby you are going to look for the usage of those IoT data in a more privacy manner. Another important thing is please look into that cloud or some of those aspects do not store any critical business or personal data in the internet cloud. That is the most important thing as far as the IoT applications are concerned. And of course, do not store any password in your IoT devices or anywhere in the internet cloud. See, it is very much vulnerable and your IoT devices are very much prone to hack. And so you need to make sure that this critical information is avoided in your IoT devices or in the cloud. So do not install any malware without verifying its authenticity. Those are things that comes into picture. And of course, more regularly, you need to make sure that if you are not using any IoT devices in your network, please do remove your IoT devices. If they are malfunctioning or if they are not active, so you need to remove them. Otherwise, there is a high risk that through those devices, there can be a lot of hacking can be done. And of course, your business, your finance and banking related companies should store the data and retain them till they need it. Once they are no longer required, you need to delete them and to, so that you can minimize those for your possible hackings. So these are the some of the points. Please go through this. And of course, the points have been collected from this particular chapter, M2M and IoT Technology Fundamentals. So basically, this completes the unit number one. So let me just brief you about this unit one, what we have discussed so far. So, and the sources where I have taken for you so that it will be easy for you to quickly refer to this. I hope, are you able to see my screen, please?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So if you see here, the unit number one, this is basically an introduction to IoT. Now here in this, what are the things that we discuss here? So if you quickly recap, we have seen what are the different IoT architectural overviews or the different architectures of IoT. Can anybody recollect this one? What are the different architectures of an IoT?
The Cisco architecture?
M2M and...
Oh, no, okay. not M2M, Baba. It is, you are confused, I think, with that M2M. Yes, Cisco has given this. And apart from Cisco, what is that another basic architecture which we discussed?
IoT World Forum.
It is World Forum, IoT. And you see, basically, what are the common architectural characteristics about these two systems? What are the common things that you observed between these two architectures? Yes, please.
Both are similar to OSI, sir. Is that?
Both are similar to?
OSI model, sir. The layering.
OSI reference model will be there. But if you see here, so this is a reference model of the IoT World Forum. So these are different layers. So physical layer, connectivity layer, edge computing layer, data accumulation, data abstraction, application and collaborative processes. And if you see this IoT reference model, the features are there. Now, if you see the Cisco or Oracle or IEEE standards, if you see all are in the layers, of course, as you mentioned, these are your OSI reference layers. But more specifically, what is the important characteristics that you observe between these 3 to 4 architectural models? A common architecture, you can generate it. A common architecture can be built. Usually that common architecture is, at the bottom layer, you'll have the physical devices. Please see here. And the physical devices means your daily objects, whatever objects you are using, that will be there at the bottom layer. And at the middle layer, you will have the communication networks or your communication capabilities and the data storage. And of course, at the top layer, you will have the different applications, how they are communicating, how they are going to be used by this particular set of devices at the top layer. So that's how you need to look here. So if you see, these are the reference architectures that we have seen here and how this and what are the design principles. So if you see here, what are the IoT design principles and the needed capabilities. When you want to design an IoT network or when you want to design an IoT application, so this is what the syllabus is. The syllabus, if you look here again, I'm just coming to this. So according to the syllabus, we moved on to understanding the introduction to IoT, then followed by the design principles and the needed capabilities. Of course, IoT applications in everywhere you are using in most of the almost all the domains. And we have understood about what is sensing, what is a sensor, what is an actuator, and of course the basics of networking. Then we move on to M2M and IoT technology fundamentals. So this M2M and IoT technology fundamentals, from here to all these aspects, please, whatever the things I highlighted are from this particular textbook. Please refer to this textbook. The textbook is this. Once again, I already kept that material to you. So the reference material which are here you have seen. So this is the textbook chapter. So in this chapter also, please do not, you need not read the complete chapter. So if you look here carefully, M2M IoT technology fundamentals, you have to look for devices and gateways. So this section 5.1 complete thing is required for you. What are the basic devices, how your data management can be done, and what are your advanced devices. So this is what section 5.1. Then comes your data management. So what are the different types of data, how the data is getting managed in this for your M2M and IoT, that is section number 5.3. So section number 5.2, if you want, you can study it, but you can avoid, you can skip this one. As far as the syllabus is concerned, this 5.2 is not there, because you might already studied in your computer networking course. What is local area network? What is wide area networks? And what is the difference between local area and wide area networks? And what are the technologies for your local area network and wide area networks? So if you want to refer and if you want to understand, you can read this 5.2. Otherwise, you can skip it. But for as the syllabus is concerned, so you have this chapter number 5.1, devices and gateways. Chapter number 5.section number 5.3, data management. Section number 5.4, business processes in IoT. And of course, the section number 5.5. The 5.5 is everything as a service. This is what we discussed today. What is everything, whatever you are using, the physical things which are connected with each other in our day-to-day life, with the help of cloud management, you are receiving those services. This is what we discussed from this particular book. So if you go through this chapter, the basic types, the advanced types, the deployment scenarios, where you are using these different types of devices in different applications. So what is the basic types? What is this microcontroller? What does a microcontroller, along with the microcontroller, what does you have? What are the other components? So a microcontroller consists of what? What is a gateway? What does a gateway do? And what is the data management? This is a little bit elaboration is there in this following sections. So please go through this. And if you have any doubts, you can ask me. Maybe in the next classes or other classes, but most of the contents for this you are taken from this particular book only. You can see the diagrams. Of course, the diagrams is also belongs to these books. So this is the business processes of this IoT, and you can distribute business process of IoT. Of course, the matter, the content I have not given, but I have explained and described. So you can refer to the video session. Recorded video session, otherwise you can ask me the doubt. So today is this everything as a service. We just discussed about what is meant by on-demand services and what are the characteristics of cloud computing. Similarly, what are the different types of clouds or models which are available, and what are the different services we have it. So this all completes the first unit. And now, since the first unit is completed, so let us see here the assignment for this. So apart from this first unit, I also discussed about the basic thing on the unit number 2. So here, this unit number 2 in the syllabus is, if you see, we just started about the Arduino boards and the Raspberry Pi. So unit number 2 also, we are trying to understand what are the different computing devices such as your Arduino and Raspberry Pi. So we started programming on this already in the unit number 2. So based on whatever the topics I covered so far, we have this assignment. So let me just make you to understand what this assignment and what you need to do. So this, you can see the assignment here. I can download the copy. So here, the first question on this assignment one is basically, is my screen visible to you?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Yeah. Yes. See, this question is basically related to the Android mobile app. So one demonstration I have given to you to how to use the accelerometer sensor, which is there on our mobile devices. So you need to create an app, just very simple question. You need to create a mobile app that lists what are all the available sensors on your mobile phone. So each one of you may have different types of mobile phones. So it is not that common thing that everybody has the same set of sensors. No. So you, depending on your mobile device, you please list all those available sensors on your mobile device. So for this, you need to just write a small app with a simple function and run the app on your device and on the emulator to use the sensors. If you are going to install your emulator, you can as well show your use your emulator to show the virtual sensors. Create a second app that gets data from the light and proximity sensors and displays the data. So most of the mobile phones, you will have your light sensor and as well as your proximity sensor. See, the example what I have shown is on the accelerometer. Similarly, you can use your light and proximity sensors of your mobile phone. If you don't have your proximity sensors on your mobile phone, most likely 99.9% your accelerometer will be there. So you can use your accelerometer and you can complete that exercise here for the second app. So now you need to interact with the device and note the changes in sensor data. You have to see the sensors data which is on your mobile app, like what I have shown for X, Y, Z values of your accelerometer. So you can use your Android app, or you can, if you want to use your iOS, you can use your iOS. So you, for that, if you are using an Android app, a simple program looks like this. So this program, already I have given you a small demo how to run this one. So you can use this particular class and very simple program to display your data of your sensors. So to display what are all the sensors available, and for each sensor, how to display the data in the text boxes and creating your user variables, you can display that values. Very simple program. So you can run for this. If you will see the demo, what I have given you, you will give them more idea. But you need to explore a little bit. So if you at all you have some difficulty, please let me know. And during the Friday sessions, or you can ask me through email also. This is one mobile app to get your sensors data to be displayed here. That is one exercise. And the second exercise is you can use your fridging circuit to create a circuit like this to connect your LED and your potentiometer. And you can use your simulator, using the Uno Arduino simulator. So you need to dim your LEDs based on the analog values that have been coming from the potentiometer. So you change your potentiometer and you try to glow the LED light. Not only glowing, you need to dim and make it bright, depending on the changing the values of the potentiometer. This is, you can using fridging circuit, you prepare the circuit, and as well as through your Arduino simulator, you write the code and execute it. Now coming to the third question, this is one simple exercise. Everybody should be able to do it. So here, you can see the scenario here. Can anybody tell me what do you understand from this figure? Just observe the figure and tell me.
Sir, water tank is, if it is full, yeah, then we have to do something, and if it is low, we have to do something, kind of thing.
Very good. Very simple. Very simple diagram to understand here. So this is a sump is there, and water is been means water is been poured into this sump, and of course there are two pipes are there, P1 and P2, and these two pipes are going to be functional based on certain conditions here. Basically, functional in the sense the water is going to be pumped onto this pipe. Water is going to be taken by these pipes. When the water is going to be taken is based on certain conditions. So let us see, before going to the conditions, see the scenario over here. So there is low and high. So please see here carefully, what is this low mark and what is this high mark? So in this sum with certain height, you put a transducer. So what is a transducer, please?
Converts one form of energy to another.
A transducer converts one form of energy to another. Now, in this scenario, what type of transducer do you keep or do you prefer to have it for this application here to monitor the low level and high level? Yes, please.
We can measure the pressure, sir.
No, no, it is not a question of pressure, Amma. This is water level here. Water is being pumped into this sump and the level of the water increases when the water is being pumped into this sump continuously. The level increases. Okay. Somebody says a transducer is a converts one form of energy to another energy. What are the different types of transducers that we discussed so far? Forgot. Most of the people have forgot. Am I audible to you, please?
Yes, sir.
A transducer can be a sensor. A transducer can be a what is a sensor, please? Hello. Hello, am I audible to you?
Yeah. It measures some physical phenomenon and converts it to like an electrical signal sort of thing.
Need not be the electrical. Okay, let me just show you the slide. I will show the slides again for you. Where are we? Yeah, sensors and actuators. Please go to the sensors and actuators topic. Now see here carefully. Where I have given the definition for a transducer, in which particular slide, please? Transducer definition I have given to you in a particular slide. Can you please recollect in which particular slide it is? Please read here carefully. What is written on this slide? Can anybody tell me?
Yes, sir. A sensor is a transducer.
Sensor is a transducer. What is written in the same slide, please? An actuator is also a
transducer.
Yes. So what are sensors and actuators? Basically, they are transducers. So what is a transducer? Is any physical device that converts one form of energy into another. Then what is the difference between a sensor and an actuator?
A reverse sensor is an actuator.
Yes. So actuator is nothing but a reverse of a sensor. Very good to remember that particular point. So here, so an actuator controls the environment. Basically, any device, you see, it is something like in your air conditioner, you have to switch off your air conditioner, switch off. How your switch on and switch off can be done? There must be some device which can switch off and switch on. Are you getting this point? See, in this small example, you can see here, there is a temperature sensor detects the heat. And once it detects the heat, it sends this detected signal to control center. So the control center is going to send a signal to switch on and switch off. Control center sends commands to sprinkler. Sprinkler is another device here. So what is the device you use here to make the sprinkler on and off? That is basically your actuator. Actuator is also a transducer, but a reverse of this sensor. So the sensor basically, it takes some physical phenomenon into electrical impulse. Whereas this actuator takes that electrical impulse, that is your switch on and switch off, into your physical, into the physical environment, or into act according to the physical situation, or the physical object is going to be controlled. The physical object here is the sprinkler to be made it on or off. So this is an actuator here. So here, so in this example, the one which I am showing you here, what type of transducer do you require here? In this assignment diagram, here I need two transducers to check whether the height of this water flow has reached to certain level, either to the low level or to your high level. So you put some markers, high and low markers are you kept at a certain distance. So how do you come to know water has reached to a certain level?
Sir, we have to use sensors.
Very good, very simple answer. That's what I'm expecting the answer. You need to have a sensor here already. S0 and S1 are given here. S stands for sensor here. So one sensor is required to check the flow of this one. One sensor is at the low level and another sensor is at the higher level. So if water reaches to this higher level, automatically the sensor senses that water has reached to this level. And obviously something is going to happen here. So let us see this scenario here. So what is that you have to do here is, so please look into this diagram. Here consider a system to maintain the water level in the sump between the levels high and low. So water has to be in between low and high only. So two transducers, high and low, are used to monitor the level. That's what basically these transducers are, nothing but your sensors. So water is pumped out of those, out of the two pumps. Okay. Assume appropriate conditions. So you have to assume different conditions. So different students can assume different conditions here. Please remember. So I don't want to give conditions here. If I give the conditions, then you people will miss the same conditions will apply for each one of you. So I don't want to give. So you have to prepare your own conditions and write the program accordingly. So here you can use whatever the Arduino microcontroller we have discussed earlier using the simulator. You can mimic this one, the same scenario. So use your pumps as an LEDs, and that LED should be on and off based on those transducers values. So you can depict this scenario using the Arduino simulator here. So you can use this. Please use the scenario, put your conditions properly, set your LEDs. Your P1 and P2 can be your LEDs, so that the water level is in between low and high. It should not be more than high, it should not be more than low. So when it is more than high, which particular pump should take care of water, either pump P1 or P2 or both pumps? If it is low, which pump has to be taken care or water should be pumped again back? So here you need to take those conditions and simulate this scenario using your LEDs and your push buttons and your potentiometer of your simulator. So that scenario you need to narrate it. So I want each one of you to put your own simulating conditions and narrate this example here for you to depict this. Yes, please.
Sir, we will also have to represent P1 and P2 using some LED, or like how we will represent pipes in our simulator?
See, that pipes are nothing but your LEDs here. LED will be one. Then when LED one and two will be on, you please. Okay, now simple one example I will give to you here. One condition is like that. So when the water level is very high means it has reached to the one sensor here, sensor S1. When it is reached to the sensor S1, your LED P1 and P2 should be on. Okay, P1 and P2 is on means both the pumps are taking away the water from this sump. Are you getting this point?
Yes, sir.
So now there can be multiple conditions here. I have given only one condition here as such with one example. You please assume, or you please narrate what are the different conditions you get. You can get around 6 conditions. You can get it here. I don't want to disclose. So you need to have some your creativity and imaginativity in controlling this low and high with these two pumps with your Arduino simulator. That's what I would like to hear from you.
Sir, instead of the sensor, we should use a push button or something.
Yes, that's what you can. Now, see, a button is also a sensor. Please remember. Please look to my slides again. Hello?
Yes, sir.
So please go through my materials properly and try to understand. If you don't understand, you please ask me in the interactions or in email. Okay. Let me complete this 4 and 5 and we'll get back to you if you don't mind. So now using the fourth question is using Arduino simulator, perform the following instructions. Of course, this kind of example on that day, somebody has demonstrated also, but it is not completed. So what I want here is it reads an analog input. So zero from the pin number zero converts into voltage. So it's basically ADC conversion. So whenever you change the at A0 or A1, the corresponding value, digital values has to be displayed. So if you are putting from 0 to 3, you need to display the values from 0 to 1023. If you are putting from 0 to 5 volts, you have to display it from 0 to 1023. If you are displaying it from 0 to 100, it's still displays from 0 to 1023. So that is what your A and B questions are there. And once you complete this A and B, you should be able to use that sim in the Arduino simulator. There is a servo motor is there. So that servo motor also can be controlled by turning the shaft from the left to right by rotating it for 180 degrees. So use the same, you know, Arduino simulator and perform these ABCs. Now coming to fifth question. So this question is, most of you have already seen the Raspberry Pi simulator using WildRoot in Studio. So you have to build your own applications with the LEDs and buttons, which are already there in the simulator. So build your own application, at least two applications please, and submit the codes accordingly. So no two students will have the same application, please. I expect that. So you need to build your own two applications. Application can be any real world application with respect to the usage of these LEDs and buttons. So you need to prepare some kind of application like what I have shown you in terms of your water pump of these things. So that kind of applications, you need to narrate it, you need to execute and submit the codes. Yes. Now let me just come back to your discussions on these clarifications. Yes, tell me now, what is the doubt? Somebody was pausing me, please. Please get back to your questions.
Sir, and the third question is, water continuously flowing into the tank?
No, it is from the P1 and P2. You can narrate it up to you, assuming that your P1 and P2 are again connected to this water. So it is continuously, water is flowing out and flowing in through those pipes only. If you want, you can have an external pipe to control.
Okay.
So it is, okay, I'm giving just an assumptions for you. You can assume it and you prepare your scenario. I don't want to restrict with a particular scenario only here. I hope I'm clear to you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. What I want is basically you prepare your scenario and you narrate that scenario with our Arduino board. So since we don't have the real Arduino boards here, at least you use the simulator and complete those exercises, please. Yeah. Any other queries, please? Please let me know.
Sir, you asked us to submit those fridging circuits, no, sir? We should send the .fzz file or just screenshot?
Yes, the screen prints of your final thing, screen print, you can see. Yeah, one more thing. In this assignment, I have already put this instruction for you. You have to submit your schematics. That's what your fridging schematic is, the circuit diagram. That's called schematics. Bharadwaj, are you able to get it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. The schematic.
Regarding this thing only, sir, we need to just send a screenshot of that schematic page or the whole file.
See, if you don't develop the schematic from the fridging, you will not be able to run the code on the simulator.
Okay. Okay.
You will be able to run that code on the simulator only when your schematic is correct.
Yes,
your pins are connected. Please remember that point. And by what date you have to submit this assignment, please?
In Moodle, the deadline was given April 20.
Yes. So in the Moodle, it is already there. Still, you have 14 days time. So at least daily one exercise. If you do it, you'll be able to complete at least once in 2 days. One exercise is enough for you to complete these 5 exercises, please. If you have not understood the question, please let me know. I'll explain it again and again. This is not a problem for me. These assignments is completely on what are the topics we covered so far. And next coming Friday class, so please make sure that your Raspberry Pi emulator is installed on your systems. So the Raspberry Pi emulator experiments will start from Friday class, please. Any other queries, please? Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir, audible.
Yes,
sir. Any other queries? Anwar Ali. Anwar Ali, are you online, please? Anwar Ali. I think he left the meeting. So in the beginning, he was there. If you do not have any queries at this moment, then I'll wind up the session. Again, we'll meet on Friday morning, 9 o'clock. Is it okay?
Yes,
sir.
Yes. Thank you. Okay, take care. See you on Friday. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.